to pray in the valley low. And how hard your fight has been, how deep the pain within. Wounds that no one else has seen, hurts too much to show.
Well, good morning. It's a joy to see you all here as we worship at Atlantic Highlands Navasink UMC. Friends, for those of you who I don't know, I'm Pastor Nicole. Welcome. Whether you're here in person or online, I am glad that you are here. We've got a lot of fun things coming throughout this week. We've got a new Bible study starting on Thursday, to be or not to be the church. So we've got 7 o'clock for sure on Thursday. We're still trying to figure out if that 3 o'clock is going to happen or not. So sign up today. Let me know so that we can make sure that you have the information you need to be a part of that. We've got the blessing of the animals on Saturday at 10 o'clock. We'll be out here in the parking lot. All are welcome. Just be sure that those pets are leashed or crated or in a tank because just please. If it does rain, keep an eye on the Facebook page. If there is rain, we will have to cancel/postpone the event. So just keep an eye on the Facebook, and I'll put a sign out for those of you who aren't on Facebook so you know what's going on. But if there's actively water falling from the sky, like not a drizzle, but like a lot of water, just know we're postponing. We've also got next Sunday, the 15th is the crop walk. So if you want to be a part of that, simply talk to me or Cheryl, and we'll be able to gather together and fight to relieve some of the hunger insecurities that are in our community. And then there was Charge Conference is on October 22nd. It's at 1:30 over at St. John's in Hazlitt. All are welcome to come to just kind of attend to and celebrate all that's happened in the church the last year, all that we're planning for in the year ahead. Just take some time to be in worship together and to celebrate and to talk about all that's coming for this place next year. So as far as I know, that's all we've got. Oh, we've got coffee hour after worship today. I know this is a lot of announcements. I'm sorry. But we've noticed that you guys tend to have you've started this trend of having a conversation here in the aisle at the end of worship. So just go ahead and have it over there. We've got coffee and snacks as we just spend some time in fellowship with one another, living life together as Jesus has called us to do. That's it. So let us together just take a deep breath and let us turn our hearts and minds to the worship of our Lord. Let us greet each other with the peace of Christ by saying, "Peace be with you," and responding, "And also with you." Peace be with you.
Join me in the invitation to worship. We gather together, empowered by the risen Christ, to worship and encounter the Holy One. We trust that the infinite love of God will move us beyond our places of doubt and fear, and into a world where our witness points to the good news.
Thank you.
You may be seated. Please join me in the centering prayer. Come, Holy Spirit, come. We rejoice that you are constantly yearning to be in a deeper relationship with us. May those who come with doubts encounter you in profound ways. May those who come with faithful confidence encounter you in profound ways. And may we all be empowered to bear witness to the light of the world. Amen. The scripture lesson today is from Matthew chapter 28, verses 16 to 20, the commissioning of the disciples. Now the 11 disciples went to Galilee, to the mountain to which Jesus had directed them. When they saw him, they worshiped him, but some doubted. And Jesus came and said to them, "All heaven, all authority in heaven and on earth has been given to me. Go, therefore, and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit, and teaching them to obey everything I have commanded you. And remember, I am with you always to the end of the age." For the word of God in Scripture, for the word of God among us, for the word of God within us. Thanks be to God.
Triumph.
poem by William Shakespeare in the 1600 tragedy Hamlet. And since then, this line has infiltrated society everywhere from Charlie Chaplin and Kurt Vonnegut to Star Trek and George of the Jungle. The characters weigh options between life and death in the case of Hamlet, or just generally comparing equal but opposite actions. Now, the past few weeks, we've been exploring the actions of the fastest growing church as we journeyed through the book of Acts, and we watched as the early church spent time proclaiming the gospel, witnessing to those places where they were seeing God at work in the world, and we saw how thousands came to believe in Jesus Christ. We saw how they took leadership in their own homes, in the church, in the community at large. And we saw how that blossomed into a unity in and through Christ, which transforms not only their individual lives, but the whole world at large. And as we continue to grow deeper in our faith together, we are now called to ask the question, to be or not to be the church. The church, friends, is not a building. It's not the steeple, it's not a resting place, it is the people. Church is not a place that you go, it's something that you are and something you do. Because encounters with Jesus change people, and not just for a moment, but by transforming us into something new. And we're not new by ourselves, we become a part of a community that's held together and sent out by the Holy Spirit to introduce more people to Jesus in a transformative way. To be the church is to do God's mission in the world. And when we join in our scripture lesson today, this is the moment where Jesus' closest followers are told just that. Now, as we join in Matthew today, we do so just after the Easter story. And I know that we are many months out from our celebration of Easter, but in Matthew's timeline, the resurrection has just happened. The disciples have not seen the risen Jesus yet. Only Mary Magdalene and the other Mary, as Matthew calls her, have seen and spoken to Jesus. And they have brought a message to the disciples that they are to travel to Galilee to meet Jesus. So we join in on the top of this mountain where Jesus has asked them to gather. Now Matthew says that when the disciples saw Jesus, they worshiped Jesus, just like Mary Magdalene and Mary did at the empty tomb that Easter morning. But some of them doubted. The disciples, despite working with Jesus day and night, were not perfect. They still had some fear and some doubt. They saw Jesus for who he truly was, the Son of God, whose life and death and resurrection broke the chains of sin and death, and yet they were not perfect. They still had some fear and doubt. And these disciples who called Jesus Lord and Savior with all of their heart, with all of their soul, with all of their mind, still were not perfect. They still had some fear and some doubt. Now, Matthew doesn't tell us what they doubted, but I don't really think it matters much. Because I like to imagine that the doubts that they had stemmed from not being able to fully understand all aspects of the faith. Like why Jesus had to die, or how that restores us in our relationship with God. They question Jesus' resurrection, his ascension, and we see them ask questions throughout all of the Gospels, wondering why it is that it had to be this way. But my favorite part about the scripture we read this morning are the words from Jesus, because he calls them to have faith and to do ministry in the world despite their fear and their doubt. This is part of the Gospels we call the Great Commission. It's the mission that Jesus asks all of his followers to continue. Go and make disciples, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, and teach them to obey everything that I have commanded you, and remember that I am with you always, to the end of the age. Friends, the disciples are being pursued and persecuted by the government because they believe that they stole Jesus' body. And the disciples have 1,000 other things to do. So I can imagine those arguments that were happening on that mountaintop. You want me to go, Jesus? Yes. Go from the place where you feel most comfortable and see me elsewhere. You want me to make disciples, Jesus? Yes. Go help others to hear and learn what I have taught you. Really, though, Jesus, of all nations? Yes. Even those who don't look like you, who don't think like you, who don't act like you. But baptizing them, Jesus, that's the role of a pastor. Yes, it is, but you don't have to pour water on them to baptize them. It means to help work with them towards converting to believing in me as you show them how to be disciples. But teach them, Jesus. That's the role of the pastor too. Well, yeah, it is, but it's your job too. How else do they become disciples? And they turn around and they say, for real, Jesus, what do you want me to do? Go. Teach. Do. But Jesus, even we don't fully see. Even we don't fully hear. Even we don't always fully obey. Jesus says, it's okay. We'll get better. Because I am right here with you. Friends, it's a mighty task that comes with a great promise. We don't have to have it all figured out to do what God has called us to do because Jesus promised to be with us always in the power of God's word and of the Holy Spirit. We have been called to love, and loving is hard. But Jesus has promised to walk with us through it. Jesus has promised to walk with us through the doubt, through the understanding that we are indeed beloved and cherished and forgiven children of God whom are dearly, dearly loved. But friends, here's the other part of this story. If we never meet Jesus on the mountaintop, we'll never hear the call to go. If we never meet Jesus on the mountaintop, we'll never hear the call to teach. If we never meet Jesus on the mountaintop, we will never hear the great promise that Jesus will be with us always through the power of God's word and Holy Spirit as we go out and do what God has called us to do. Many of us show up in this building on a Sunday morning in a spirit of prayer and worship to meet Jesus on the mountaintop. But what would happen if we didn't come here? Friends, some of you know this by now, but I didn't start going to church until I was in middle school. I had a very basic understanding of the meaning behind Christmas and Easter. I had a very basic understanding of prayer as a conversation with God. It wasn't until someone invited me into a church building for something unrelated to God that I began to see the building as something other than just that building next to the cemetery. But for some people, that building or any church building is a scary and a harmful place. Because some experienced abuse, some immense pain due to who they are, by the people, by the clergy. Some harsh and judgmental opinions about how people show up in the world. Some who came to a church building only in times of grief. Friends, that's not their mountain to climb. We know that Jesus does not spend time only on the mountaintops. We know that Jesus is down in the darkest valley. Jesus is out in the wilderness, out in the fields, in the homes of the people. So why do we as a church expect others to come when we watch Jesus and are told by Jesus to go?
Jesus says, go and make disciples, not bring them to church and let your pastor make disciples. Jesus says, convert them and teach them, not bring them through the doors and forget about them. Jesus says, remember, not remember while you're at church and forget the second you walk out the door. Friends, we're called to come to our mountaintop places of worship and prayer and in community to be supported and encouraged, to gather around the table in communion to be nourished, to see God in real and tangible ways, because it's hard some days to know where God is at work in the world. But then we're called to go, to draw people into the family of Christ and to teach them by showing them how to love, by being a people who love. And then maybe, just maybe, we can climb up the mountaintop together to see our risen Savior. Friends, we're called to walk with Jesus, no matter what fear, no matter what doubt we have. We are called to love God and to love others because God loved us first. God loves us in ways that we don't fully understand. That is God's gift to us, offered without a price. So in gratitude and in thanksgiving, we turn around and love our neighbors. Go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, and teaching them to obey all that I have commanded you, and remember that I am with you always to the end of the age. Go. Teach. Do. Friends, this is what Jesus has called us to. As we gather on this mountaintop, we get to praise and worship God. But then we're called to come down off the mountain and to meet people where they are, to love others in the best ways that they can, in the best ways that we can, so that God might be known to all, so that all might hear a word of grace and love. Let us pray together. Good and gracious God, we give you thanks for your gift of love and grace. We give you thanks for the freedom that you have given us. Freedom from slavery to sin and death. Freedom from fear. And God, even though there are days where we are concerned and we doubt, you have promised to be with us always. God, grant us your peace. Help us to feel your love, to see you at work in the world, and know how we might be able to join you in that work. God, as we gather together, we have committed to pray for one another, to support one another, to encourage one another, and to lead by example. God, you know all that weighs on our hearts and on our minds. God, you know those around us who are sick and injured, for those who are in need of comfort and guidance, for those who are in need of your love in ways that are easily seen and felt. God, hear now the names of those that weigh heavy on our hearts and on our minds. God, we know you hear our prayers and that you answer them in your time and in your way. God, help us to see those moments where you are answering that prayer and those moments where we are called to be the answer to someone else's prayer. God, remind us in every moment to love others. Remind us in every moment that we are called to love you. Remind us in every moment that we are loved by you. God, thank you for all that you have done for us, especially for the gift of your Son, Jesus Christ, who is our Lord, our Savior, and our friend, the one who taught us to pray together, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Friends, when we gather together in worship, we give thanks for not only the love and grace that God gives us, but for all that God gives us. And we take the opportunity to reflect and to give back our prayers, our presence, our gifts, our service, and our witness to the mission that God has called us to love God, to love people, to welcome all. Friends, at this moment, I invite you to give as you're willing and able to simply sit and reflect on what God has given you and how you might be able to turn around and go and teach and do. If our ushers will please come forward. Together. Eternal Creator, we want to climb to high places and experience your glory. Empower us to be your witnesses and go out to make more witnesses. Lead the way. We give you our prayers, our presence, our gifts, our service, and our witness. Trusting that they will supply for your mission and works. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. Friends, Jesus calls us to go and teach and do. Let us sing together this hymn, Go, Make of All Disciples.
Thank you.
Disciples of Jesus Christ. We're called to baptize, to help convert them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. We're called to go, to teach, and to do. I'm not sure why Joe is up here at the moment.
I was hoping you would ask. So October is Pastor Appreciation Month, and we just happen to have a great pastor here with us. And we have, on behalf of the SPR committee, we have decided that October 8th is going to be Pastor Nicole Day here at the Atlantic Highlands Davison Church. So we have planned a fellowship hour for you.
That's why.
Bingo.
All right.
You're posing the question to us this month, to be or not to be the church. We are definitely the church and a better church because of you. So,
thank you.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
You can have the sermon back.
Thank you. As I was saying, friends, go and teach and do. Bear witness to the love of God in this world, so that to those whom love is a stranger, find in each and every one of you a generous friend. Amen.